is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope.
Voice of Hope.
This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope.
Voice of
Hope. Made him who had no sin,
so that we might become his righteousness.
Instead of ourselves, he offered him.
So that we might become his righteousness.
So that
we might become his righteousness.
So that
we might become his righteousness.
Oh, oh.
Holy God was offered for us.
So
we might become his righteousness.
So that
we might become his righteousness.
It's hard to believe we can be spiritually well.
Announcement. Cherished listener, please take note of the change in frequency. Our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014. I repeat, our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014.
We might become his righteousness.
The loving God tasted the essence of hell.
So that we might become his righteousness.
So that
we might become his righteousness.
So that
we might become his righteousness.
Oh, oh.
Holy God was offered for us.
So
we might become his righteousness.
God in the flesh lived as a man,
will of the Father
fulfilling his plan. Jesus condemned, taking our place.
Now we are in him
and we'll see his face.
God made him who had no sin.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Praise means praises. The full meaning of praise can be found in its old French origin. Praiser, which means to prize. Praise means to value, esteem, and cherish. Think what this means when we praise God. Psalm 148. He can do it. One of the qualities of God is that he is immutable. He does not change. Hence, his mighty acts that were performed for others in the Bible. He is more than capable of doing for you today what he did in Bible times. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8. Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8 and Malachi chapter 3 verse 6. This was read from the book God's Little Book of Prayer by Richard Daly, and my name is Andrew Boateng Bexon.
listener. This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I'll lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I'll lead you home.
Welcome, listener, to your favorite youth program, Youth Corner. I am your host, Russell Mensah, and today we are continuing with our discussion on when, how, and whom to date. In studio with me, I have
Ben Justice Rivinti,
Esther Senkansa,
John Johnson,
John Opata.
Panelists, you are welcome.
Thank you.
So, listener, if you would remember, the last time we were looking at how to date from the perspective of the Christian. Who wants to pick out a non-believer, take the person to the church, marry the person, and convert the person. However that ends, I leave it to you to decide. But today, we want to continue from there. Are there any elements to look out for in a relationship? In that, we're asking ourselves, how do we date? These days, you hear comments like, she's a friend with benefits. Or, it's all right for me to be having sexual experiences with this person. After all, it's actually expected. What is your take on these issues, Esther?
Friends with benefits. Well, that's a new one. But I didn't know it was part of the whole dating thing now. Wow. I'm so shocked about that. But anyway, you don't go ahead to date thinking like Mr. Nsedu said from our previous discussion, thinking about what the other person can give to you or what you can give to the other person. It's about yourself. It's about being compatible with the individual. Imagine you start dating and you start sleeping with a person or having sex with a person and you realize you're not compatible. How do you break up with a person when more or less the person owes you now or you owe the person? So dating, like we are saying, is informal. Maybe going to the movies, chatting, calling each other once in a while. That is in itself is okay rather than getting too emotionally attached.
I would say that as a yardstick, don't start something you are not ready to continue. For instance, when you're dating and then you start having sex, people are binding that thing you are not really ready to continue. When you begin to realize that there are issues here and there, that binding that you both had will now be sort of a challenge for you people now. So I would say that in dating, don't start something you're not willing to continue.
Okay, then I'll add to what they have just said is, we all said here that dating is not a binding relationship. And since it is not binding, you don't do things that are binding. And you can date as many women or as many men as you want. So why get hooked to one when you're not really ready to move that relationship into courting and even move it that next level into marriage?
So let's clarify this. That binding element is the sex?
Not just the sex, but an emotional attachment. When you become emotionally attached, that young ladies and young men will say fall in love instead of standing in love before, you know? So once you fall in love with your date, you become emotionally attached. And then that is where all those other things would come in. But if it is just a date that you had, it's probably somebody calls you, let me take you out, let's go take a drink somewhere, or let's go to the movie, let's go to the pool or to the beach, or go take a meal, and that should end up in bed. That is off the mark, and just off the hook, off the chain. Because I just can't fathom, I call Esther. Esther, are you free? She says, yes. Oh, there's a program here. Would you want to go? It's a date. And then she agrees to go. Isn't that a date?
It is.
And then that ends up in my bed. That is crazy. For me, it is crazy.
Ben, I want to say that when we talk about dating, as Mr. Johnson said, is it just something very casual? Oh, I want to go out with you. I want to go to cinema with you. I want to maybe just sit somewhere with you and let's chat. But there's an element everybody needs to look at. If I've been invited on a date, what is the reason behind the date? I should be able to look up or search deeper within myself. What is even the essence of that dating? then I should be thinking so that I wouldn't go and do what I cannot handle. That is where the maturity comes in. Most people may go into the dating without having that conscience, that maturity, that sense of why I am going out, what the dating will bring to me. Then they end up losing or benefiting from one point or
the other. What informs a rude intervention? Before a man will ask you out or a woman will ask you out, that person will have some liking for you. Or probably you might have had some conversation, or you have some friendship to that level that that person can invite you out. Yeah. Because if you are not friends, the person can just call you and ask you, or come to you and ask if he could go out with you. Unless, of course, the person just met you, the person likes you. The person should have some liking for you. You should have that in mind. That before I ask someone out, let's go sit somewhere. I may have had some chat with the person. I may know the person one way or the other. And I would want to probably hang around with the person. See if I can have anything fruitful or something useful
out of that.
And probably that could lead into both of you proposing and then moving on to another level and to another level.
I really beg to differ because you can't just meet someone, like you're saying, have a little bit of interaction with a person and decide to ask the person on a date. Neither can you say that you have to be friends, like friends can't go out on a date. Most of the time, we start these relationships from friendship. It gets a little deeper, even before it moves into dating, to courting, to whatever else it might end up in. So, like I'm saying, by the time it will get to the dating, there is some emotional attachment. You like the person more than maybe all your other friends.
And yeah,
that in itself is emotionally attached to it. Yeah. So you can't say dating is minus the emotions. No.
But you see, if you go out on a date, probably the first date, and then there's emotions attached, then you should know what you're calling for. Because you, the individuals out there, should guard and protect themselves in a manner that they don't fall when it gets to that.
But Mr. Johnson, I don't think that you would want to date somebody that consciously you don't like.
But the thing is, do we target as date? I ask you out. And we call it that.
So I ask you out, it's a date.
Yes, but what I'm saying is, in a person's mind, the person has his own motives for taking you out. And so, you also have your own motive
so
for
accepting
it.
Let me give you an out-of-the-ordinary scenario.
Yeah. Yeah.
I meet Esther the first time.
Okay? The very first time.
The very first time.
I've never met before.
Esther, and I have such a lovely conversation with her. Let's say I meet her at the car park.
Yeah.
We are going to sit in the car.
Yeah.
And I ask Esther, could you join me for dinner tomorrow night?
Yeah.
We are going out on a date.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And at that date, what we are saying is we shouldn't get emotionally involved.
Yeah.
Because then I developed that liking for her when I had that first conversation with her.
Yeah.
And that's what motivated my asking her out.
Yeah.
And so on that date, are we saying it is not safe to develop any emotions?
Russell, just to say something, it's like not an expression
of feeling.
Of feelings. And feelings and emotions.
Yes.
Yeah. So if you are saying don't attach emotions to it, what kind of emotions are you talking about?
And should you just go sit there, you know? So you're not being realistic, seriously. You're not being realistic.
One of the reasons why I'm saying you should hold on to your emotional attachment to your dates is that emotions can lead to other things which you yourself will not want. So you should rather use reasoning rather than emotions.
Okay, so I've heard this expression, let's walk in love, let's not fall in love. We'll look at that a lot more at our next sitting. Today in studio, I've had John Johnson, John Opata, Ben Justice Bibinti, and Esther Nkansa. And we've been having a discussion on when, how, and whom to date. Thank you, listener, for tuning in. Tune in again next time. Bye-bye.
World Radio Ghana,
Voice of Hope.
AWR, Voice of Hope. We will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
On the resurrection morning, when all the dead in Christ shall rise, I'll have a new body, praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Sown in weakness, raised in power, ready to live in paradise. I'll have a new body, praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Oh yes,
I'll have a new home,
glory, glory,
where the redeemed
ever stand.
No
more pain, there'll be no more strife.
Yes, raising the light,
in so this life,
we're ready to live.
I'll be glad.
I'll have a new body.
Praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. What a hallelujah morning when the last trump of God shall sound.
I'll have a new body.
Praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Graves all bursting, saints all shouting, heavenly beauty all around. Praise the Lord, I'll have a new life. Oh yes,
I'll have a new home.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
Calling for you and for me.
Calling for you and
me. See on the portal, he's waiting and watching. Watching for you and
hello,
for
listener.
Me.
I'm so excited to share the word of God with you once again. Today, we are going to consider the topic, what is your life? What is your life? Let us turn to the book of James chapter 4 verses 13 to 16. James chapter 4 verses 13 to 16. The Bible says, now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why? You do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag. All such boasting is evil. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Father, we thank you once again as we go to your word. We pray that you will be with us and help us to understand this topic. This is very important, Lord. Help us to understand, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. What is your life? Who do you think you are? A writer says, we don't see things as they are. We see them as we are. Or in our own perspective, that is happiness. Some drink alcohol, some womanize, some do other things. They think that they are enjoying life. To some, life is a race. To some, life is drinking. To some, life is going partying. To some, life is going swimming, eating with friends, misbehaving. But what is your life? What is your life? Who do you think you are? Some are playing with their lives. Some are drinking. Some are smoking. Some are womanizing. Some are also chasing women. They see these things as happiness. What is your life? What is your life? Let us continue. God's perspective in life have three metaphors. One, there are three metaphors in life. One, life is a test. God continually tests the character of faithfulness. He tests everybody. God is testing your life. God will continue to test each of us. He tested Eve, but Eve failed. He tested Abraham, and Abraham passed the test. He tested Jacob. to serve for 7 years, yet he passed. Joseph was also tested, he passed. David failed. Solomon failed. Peter failed. Judas failed. Samson failed. God is testing your loyalty. The money that has been given to you is given to you as a test. We are all accountable. We are all characters. We have to develop our character. God is developing our faith. He is testing all of us. Life is a test. Life is an examination. God is testing your faithfulness, your loyalty, your obedience. When you see life as a test, you will examine everything. Might you sleep in somebody's room? You have failed the test. When you worship an idol, you have failed the test. If you steal, you have failed the test. If you drink, you have failed the test. You and I will be tested. Our prayers will be delayed. But when your prayer is delayed, it doesn't mean God has forsaken you. He is testing your life to know whether you love him or whether you obey him or whether you walk with him. God is testing your life. My brother and sister, whatever you are going through, it is a test. Life is a test. Life is a test. And God will test you to know your faithfulness to him. When you are being criticized, just remember you are test. God will allow people to criticize you for you to stand, for you to know, for you to build up your faith. But when people criticize you, don't turn away from God because it's a test. We cannot foresee any circumstance that comes on our way. Anything that comes on your way, even if it is planned by Satan, I want you to understand that by the time that thing will finish with you, it might become the will of God. So life is a test. Even if it is planned by the devil, by the time that temptation will have finished with you, it will have become the will of God. And it will have accomplished in you what God has purposed for it to come to pass. Life is a test. Any situation in your life is a test. Every day is an important day. Every test you fail has eternal consequences. Your payday is coming. Be careful how you take care of that life that God has given to you, because life is a test. And life is like living in a hotel. When the time comes, you will check out. You see, when you are living in the hotel for some few days, when your money is finished, you must check out. Most of us will one day have to check out, because life is a test. And we will give an account of the life God has given to you. If God wants you to smoke, I think he would have created some pipes on your nose so that the smoke can pass through. But because God doesn't want you to smoke, he has given you two holes so that you can breathe. And you use the same nose to breathe in or to take in that smoke. Be careful. Life is a test. And one day you will pay for it. If God wants you to drink, you'll be drinking. One day your lungs will respond. And when your lungs respond, you will die. And you meet the one who has given them to you. My brother, why are you destroying yourself? Why are you destroying your life? Why are you destroying yourself? Why are you destroying the life that God has given to you? You will pay for it. You will account for it. God will ask you one day. And when he does, what will you tell him? My brother and my sisters, I want you to look at Jesus. Why don't you look at him? There is no habit that you cannot overcome. There is no trial that you cannot overcome. There is nothing in this world that you and I cannot do. If we want to do and we call on Jesus, even if we are powerless, he will give us the power. He will give us the grace. He will help you. He will hold your hands with his victorious right hand, and you will walk with him. What is your problem? What is it that you are struggling to overcome? Is it fornication? Is it adultery? Is it faithfulness? Whatever it is, Jesus is here. Life is a test. Jesus is here. He wants you to come to him, and that he will take your life and make a difference in your life. That same Jesus that changed Mary Magdalene is here. That same Jesus that changed King Nebuchadnezzar is here. What is your problem? Jesus is pleading with you. He is calling you. He is inviting you. He is calling you to come because he can make a difference in your life. It is my prayer today that the Lord will take control of our lives. That the Lord will build a wall of fire around you. That the Lord will help you to walk with him. Wherever you are, just stand up and lift up your hands. Just lift up your hands and ask Jesus to come into your life. When he comes into your life, any test that comes, he will give you the power and the grace to overcome. Wherever you are, lift up your hands and let's pray. Lord, you can see these people that have lifted up their hands to you. I pray that you lay your hands upon each of them. Bless them, O Lord, and give them the power of the Holy Spirit that they will overcome every test that comes on their way. Lord, continue to be with us now and forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen. I am Pastor Akawusa Dennis Elisha, AWR, Ghana.
Announcement. Cherished listener, please take note of the change in frequency. Our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014. I repeat, our current frequency of 11955 kHz will be changed to 9830 kHz from the 27th of October 2013 to the 29th of March 2014.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, please send us an email through awr@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo Ansendu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.